Hey everyone, today we're going to be looking at air masses. I want you to follow along in your meteorology or weather notes. Earlier in this unit, we looked at how weather is affected by changes in air pressure and the humidity in the atmosphere. Well, today we're going to see how those changes are related to these things called air masses.
Air masses are large regions of air that have similar characteristics from the surrounding area. Air masses can form over places like warm tropical oceans, cold, dry polar regions, or even dry deserts. As air masses move over different regions, they will gradually take on the characteristics of the new region and begin to change. As air masses move across the Earth, they will eventually run into each other. The boundaries between these two air masses are referred to as fronts.
Now, fronts are a topic that we'll tackle in the next video. But if we reverse this, we can see that air masses are essentially just big blobs of air that take on the properties of the place that they form. So they'll be either warm or cold, and wet or dry, all depending on the surface that they form over. Once they take on these properties, they move. And if we know what kind of air mass is moving towards us, we know what kind of changes to expect with the weather. So let's go to your notes. An air mass is a body of air with similar temperature and moisture content. Air mass source regions, where air masses form and get their properties. The region makes them hot, cold, wet, or dry. And the jet stream. It's a current of wind in the atmosphere that pushes air masses. It's found in the upper troposphere, and it moves from west to east. So there are five distinct types of air masses. They each have unique properties, again, based on where they form. So I want you to take a look at the map of North America in your notes. On this map, we're going to be labeling these source regions. The first is at the northernmost part of your map in the Arctic region. Here is where continental Arctic air masses form. So in this spot, I want you to draw an oval and label it lowercase c, uppercase A. This is the map symbol for continental Arctic. And what that means is that since it's forming in a very cold area, the air temperature becomes very cold. And it's forming over an area that's frozen over completely. So the air above that frozen area actually becomes very dry. So a continental Arctic air mass is very cold and dry. The next forms over the middle of Canada. This is called a continental polar air mass. So, in this part of your map, I want you to draw another oval and label it lowercase c, uppercase p. That's the map symbol for continental polar. Continental means it's forming over land, so therefore it's going to be dry. Polar means it's forming in a colder area, so these air masses are cold and dry. Not as cold as the Arctic air masses because they're not as far north. Our next air mass is called a maritime polar. Maritime means that it's forming over the ocean, so it's going to have a lot more moisture in it than the continental air masses. Polar, however, means it's cold still because it's forming in a northern more area. So, maritime polar air masses, lowercase m, uppercase p, and they're cold and wet. Notice there are two of them forming on here because there are two oceans, one on either side of North America. Now we're getting into our warmer air masses. Over the southern United States, I want you to draw another oval and label it CT, continental tropical, warm and dry. Continental now, again, means it's forming over land, so it's going to be dry. But now it's farther south, so it's going to be warmer. So we call that a tropical air mass, warm and dry. If you look to the left, you'll see our next air mass, maritime tropical. Maritime, again, means it's forming over the ocean. Tropical now again means it's forming towards the south, so we're going to have a warm and wet air mass here. And again, the map symbol is lowercase m, uppercase t. If you look to the right, you'll see more maritime tropical air masses popping up because there's two oceans. So I want you to label the areas over the Gulf of Mexico and the southern Atlantic with mt as well. Are you seeing a pattern yet? Notice all the colder air masses are up north, warmer air masses are down south. In between those, I want you to draw a set of arrows going from west to east and label that as the jet stream. Make sure your arrows are separating the cold air masses up north and the warm air masses down south.
What is the jet stream? Jet streams are bands of strong wind that generally blow from west to east all across the globe. Jet streams form when warm air masses meet cold air masses in the atmosphere. Air masses have different temperatures because the sun doesn't heat the whole Earth evenly. Areas near the equator are hot, and areas near the poles are cold. No matter the season, the primary jet streams only travel from west to east because of how Earth rotates on its axis. Jet streams can also affect our weather by impacting temperature and precipitation. Some weather systems ride the jet stream across the country. Or, if the weather system is far away from a jet stream, it might stay in one place, causing a heat wave or a flood. Monitoring jet streams can help meteorologists determine where weather systems will move next. This is important because the path of a jet stream can change quickly, taking storms in different directions. NOAA's GOSAR series satellites use infrared radiation to detect water vapor in the atmosphere. With this technology, meteorologists can monitor the location and activity of the jet streams. The GOSAR series satellites can give up-to-the-minute reports on where jet streams are in the atmosphere and where weather systems might be moving next. Find out more about Earth's weather at NOAA SciJinx.
So the jet stream's always moving from west to east, and sometimes it bends towards the north or towards the south, and it actually pushes these air masses along with it. So let's say the jet stream bends towards the south. If that happens, it's going to drag continental polar air along with it. And if we knew that was happening over us, we would expect that our weather would become colder, but probably dry out as well. On the flip side, let's say the jet stream actually bent towards the north. For us, that might mean that it's now going to drag maritime tropical air up towards us from the Gulf of Mexico. And if that were to happen, we would expect the temperature to go up, and it would probably get a lot more humid as well. So you are going to need to know the names, the map symbols, and the properties of all these air masses. The good news is that they're in your reference tables. On page 13, at the bottom, in the center, you'll see this table, air masses. Notice it's got all your map symbols there and the names of the air masses. Now, notice there's a little pattern here. The names will all start with either the term continental or maritime, and they will all end with the word Arctic, polar, or tropical. If you know what all those words mean, you know what the air mass is like. Continental polar, for example. Continental means it's dry because it formed over land. Polar means it's cold. So continental polar, cold and dry. Maritime tropical, it's just the opposite. Maritime means it's forming over the ocean, so it's going to be wet. Tropical means it's in a southern place, so it's going to be warm. So it's a wet and warm air mass. So all you're doing is you're combining those terms in different ways to find out what the air mass is like. And remember, the map symbols are simply the two-letter abbreviations for those terms. Notice the first letter is always lowercase. The second letter is always uppercase. They do that just because it will stand out on a map. And you'll see that CEA, if it has a lowercase letter, that's supposed to be an air mass. And it's not like a state abbreviation or something like that.